Hello, everyone, and thank you so much for all of your lovely comments, and thank you for writing to me and telling me what you like, that you like my show, and I'm very, very happy to be here with you tonight, of course, and I hope that we will be able to go on another journey today. This one, a little bit into the inside of trying to communicate with our inner voices. You know, I had a very, very beautiful month of Tishrei here in Crown Heights. And the most meaningful thing to me, besides being here and being in the Rebbe's space and his community and living here and experiencing the many guests and the many tables and being invited to so many homes and feeling such warmth, such love, and such Yiddishkeit. The most meaningful thing to me this month of Tishrei was my mother being here with me for 5 days. We did some major, major bonding. And in all of our years together, I don't think we've ever spent a more meaningful time than we did this past week. You know, when you grow up and you have ideas, sometimes you walk away from really looking for the essential. Parents want children to be whatever they desire. Children want to be who they want to be. And sometimes relationships really fall by the wayside because of the things we want. Not really thinking about what is it that each of us needs. Connecting with who we are on the inside. I know from my own experience that I negated for a very long time what I really wanted, what I really needed, who I really am. And in the process, I also realized that I really didn't pay attention to my own voice inside, telling me a lot of different things that I needed to know, but I just closed myself off. Mainly because I didn't want to be hurt. Mainly because I didn't want to go into an area that was always very painful to me. Mainly because I didn't want to be reminded. Mainly because I wanted to have it easier. And ultimately I realized that that wasn't an easy way out at all. That was the most difficult way I chose. But, you know, in all things that we choose, ultimately, there is an incredible, incredible lesson. So my mother being here with me this Tishrei was sort of a returning back in my life to my childhood, but now looking at my mother in a very different way than I ever have before, and seeing somebody completely different than I ever perceived in my life. And I like her. She's got her ways, we all do, and she has her opinions, and we all do, and she is non-yielding in some things and giving in on other things, and we had many, many very deep conversations like we never had before. And I think for the first time in her life, she really got a view of who I was, who I am, and whom hopefully I will become. And she kept saying throughout her visit, "I don't know you. I don't know you. I don't know who you are." And I realized that not only doesn't she know who I am, but I don't really know who she is either. And here we are, mother and daughter, and we've lived together a whole life. I mean, you know, not together in the sense of physically, but she bore me. Just like Hashem bore the world. Just like Hashem gave this world enormous potential and enormous possibility, and us such incredible, incredible worlds to live in. And we forget so easily in our day-to-day living what an extraordinary gift we were given. Being with my mother made me realize how changed the world is. When we were walking down the streets of Crown Heights, you know, she kept on saying, "I look at the faces of people and I'm reminded of the past. I'm reminded of my youth. I'm reminded of Sosnowiec, where she grew up in Poland as a child before she was taken to the concentration camp." And then she started telling me the stories of her family, of her uncle, who was a musician, of her grandmother, who was the center of the household, of her family life, the holidays, the festivals, the way life revolved around Yiddishkeit, even though she was not a religious family like my father was, but the holidays were holidays, and kosher was kosher, and Purim was Purim, and Hanukkah was Hanukkah, and Pesach was Pesach, and it was a Jewish life. And then I thought of my life. And while we lived in Germany, my father would travel for hundreds of kilometers buying kosher food and buying kosher meat for the holidays. And on Shabbos, I didn't go to school. And Friday night, it was a Shabbos table. And I remember the greatest holiday of the year, and the holiday where I miss my father the most, is Pesach, when he used to sit in his white kittel, and he used to recht up a seder. I mean really, really, really make a seder. Sit on pillows and sing the songs and the smiras and explain the going out of Egypt. This memory of my childhood lives with me always. That's what I'm looking for, to create in my own life again, to have a head of my Shabbos table, of my Yontif table, to give me that feeling of closeness and family again. But that life in Germany, even though it was very, very, very difficult, was a life that was based around the holidays, around Shabbos, around Yiddishkeit. Whereas when we came to America, everything stopped. Everything changed. I don't know why. Everything was so available here that we didn't avail ourselves of it. And I said to my mother, I said, why didn't we Kippurishlug anymore? Why did we do Kippuris anymore? You know? I remember that carp used to swim in my bathtub in Germany. And my father used to go into the bathroom, and we all went into the bathroom, and he knocked the carp over the head, and he would fling it over our heads, and it would wiggle all over the place. It was amazing. I remember these things. But it was something that made Yom Kippur Yom Kippur, you know? And when we came to America, it didn't happen anymore. High school happened, and Saturday parties happened, and Friday evening going out happened, and shul didn't happen anymore. Other things became much more important and of much greater value than worrying about shlachmonis, sending gifts to our friends for Purim. And the two of us, my mother and I, were sitting at my Shabbos table and reminiscing about what happened. And she said to me, where did you go? And I said, there was nothing to stay for. But you know something? That's not true. You make choices in life. You go for what you think you want. And I went for what I thought was right for me at that time of my life. I thought that where I was going and what I was doing was the right thing to do. And, you know, I believe that most of us really try to do the right thing. I'm really an eternal optimist, and I really believe that ultimately we all have good intentions. I think that somewhere down the line, we get lost. We take the wrong turn because the grass looks greener on the other side. And we don't want to be bogged down, and bogged down is in quotation marks, with the responsibility of what it means to observe 613 commandments. Add to that 7 rabbinical ones. We're talking about 620 commandments. Are you kidding? Is the American lifestyle, is the lifestyle of today, the jet age mentality geared toward this kind of restriction? Well, I used to think that if I gave up teaching on Shabbos, I wouldn't make a good living because Shabbos was the major day for me. And so the very last thing that I had to overcome in my way of walking with my soul is to give up teaching on Shabbos. And when I decided to do that, and I went to my students one by one, and I said, I have decided not to teach on the Sabbath anymore, and not to work on the Sabbath anymore. Can we change your lesson time? Bar none, every single one of them said to me, are you teaching on Sunday? And I said, yes, I am. And you know what? I didn't lose a thing. Everything worked out exactly the right way. I thought that it would be difficult for me not to ride to shul on Shabbos anymore. Well, I decided that I would go to the shul where I wanted to be, and I would tell them that I need to have a place where to be. And sure enough, every week I had a place where to go to spend Shabbos, where to eat my meals, in whose house to sleep, what to do for Shabbos lessons. I made it all happen. Or did I? I really don't think that I made anything happen. I think that Hashem decided that it was time for me, and he just allowed me the privilege of coming back, and he showed me the way of taking his beautiful world and living inside of it as a Jew in Yiddishkeit and being happy in it. It's not an easy road. believe me, it's not an easy road. And I don't want to make little of it. But it's a way of being. It's a way of understanding something greater than yourself. It's a way of connecting to something greater than yourself. It's allowing the way of Hashem into your life and understanding that you're walking on a way, you're walking in a way of goodness and kindness and benevolence, chesed. Your life is built upon a foundation, something that has meaning, something that is powerful inside your day. And if you set it up right, it's just the greatest. I read Tehillim every morning with my very close friend Menucha in Miami. And we find that reading Tehillim every morning and taking the Tehillim of the day, I take them right off Chabad.org in my daily study. Reading those Tehillim every morning has created a way for us to communicate away from the mundane, hi, how are you? What'd you do over the weekend? How was dinner last night? You know? All of a sudden, there will be a sentence inside the Tehillim that will bring up something in our learning, something in our thinking. And we talk about it. And when you read the words of King David, when you read these Psalms, you realize that nothing has changed. His gripes and his pains and his miseries are my miseries, and his worries and his feelings about others are my feelings about others. And his problems are my problems. And nothing has changed. The way of the world from day one is the way of the world today. I know that there is suffering in the world, and I've experienced so much of it myself. I know there is illness, and I know there is pain, and I know there are things that are way beyond anything that I can do. But I also know that there is comfort. I also know that there is a giving that human beings have, a way that they have to communicate with each other that is so beautiful, that is so miraculous, and that creates such miracles in our lives. I can tell you that my reading Tehillim every morning with my friend has changed both of our lives. The bond between us is enormously strong. And the feelings that we have when we share in the reading are bonds that go back way past this lifetime. And since we probably stood next to each other at the giving of the Torah at Mount Sinai, all we're really doing is we're reconnecting. So we're all reconnecting. We're all connected. When my mother heard me read Tehillim to my friend, she was lying here in bed next to me at 8:30 in the morning, half dozing off. She said to me afterwards, "Would you call me and read Tehillim to me too?" I said, "Well, we can do a threesome. Minucha and I are on the computer. We're on Skype.com, and we speak to each other that way. And I'll call you, and then it'll be the three of us." Well, this morning, she called me at 7:30 in the morning. She thought it was 8:30. And she said, "How come you didn't call me?" I said, "What do you mean?" She said, "Well, aren't you reading Tehillim this morning?" And I said, "Yes, Mother, but I read them at 8:30, and it's only 7:30. "Ah, I just couldn't wait, I guess." Well, at 8:30, I called her back, and she and Menucha and I read Tehillim together. And I know that all three of us had a better day because we did. So my suggestion to you is pick up Tehillim and read them every morning. And I suggest that if you don't understand Hebrew, and I speak Hebrew very well, but the language is so difficult, I read them in English so I can understand every single word. And into my conscious mind comes every beautiful expression and every meaningful thought that is written in Tehillim. And when you have special problems or special thoughts or special needs, pick up Tehillim and connect to the enormous, enormous, enormous power and greatness of David HaMelech. I want to share with you a very special moment during my prayers this Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur and Sukkot, of course. I don't think that there is a grander moment than the Birkas HaKohanim, the priestly blessing. It's always meant a great deal to me, but never more, never more than what I felt at 770. Birkas HaKohanim, the priestly blessing, blanket of holiness enfolds me, like the presence of Shekhinah covering the earth. Their powerful voices in unison soar to the heavens, opening gates for the earthbound voyager's entrance, the glimpse, a moment of vision beyond existence itself. Their sounds permeate the very fiber of the universe, elevating my spirit to lofty heights unknown, separating the veil of eternity, entering God's face. My essence ascends on angels' wings, rendering me capable of defining eternal revelation, experiencing elevation beyond fathom, rejuvenating the fundamental nature of my soul. Tears creep into my eyes, falling raindrops of past ache, stinging, relieving, freeing, blessing, releasing anguish, restructuring, healing a once tormented soul. Ancient tones redefine mundane existence, returning my beingness for cleansing into spheres divine, blending heritage, tradition, and history with the ritual progressions of supernal demands. My body flies on soft clouds of remembrances, feeling my father sway to melodious chants. Me, buried under his prayer shawl, warm and secure, safe, protected, wrapped in celestial presence of life's earthly existence. Today is yesterday's new beginning. Past is the future's forgotten moments. I exist between the breaths of two worlds. Yevarechcha. Be blessed. And the same blessings that I received and we all receive during the Birkat HaKohanim, I send to you into every corner of the world that hears my voice. Every person that needs, every person that wants, every person that desires this blessing can have it. It's really amazing. A few weeks ago, I went to a weekend retreat, and it was very lovely. It was beautiful. It was upstate New York. It was with the rabbis Jacobsons, and it was informative. We enjoyed ourselves. We met wonderful people. And Yosef Yitzchak Jacobson gave a lecture on anger management. Anger management is important in our lives. It really is. And so he spoke about the guy who messed up his computer and lost 10 years of articles and how angry he was. And he spoke about husband and wife relationships and children and parents relationships and spoke about anger in many, many different ways. Well, after the lecture, I went up to him and I said to him, "You spoke about anger in a way that is very understandable on a mundane level. And thank you for that. But what do you do when you're angry with God? How do you handle anger with God?" And he looked at me and he said, that's a very deep question, and I'll have to think about that, and I'll need to think about it and research it and whatever. And I gave him my card and I said to him, well, I said, we're neighbors, we live in Crown Heights, so perhaps if someday you get a chance, please email me your answer. But I'm sort of an impatient sort when it comes to questions that I need to work out. And so the following week, I was sitting at the table of Rabbi Aryeh Prager in Crown Heights. And Rabbi Prager is a very well-respected man, a lot older than Yosef Yitzchak Jacobson, and I guess a great deal more experience, because when I asked him the question, he looked at me, and not 10 seconds later, he answered me, Gamzu letova. Also this is for the good. I looked at him, and in that very moment, my life flashed in front of me. And everything that's ever happened, and everything that has bothered me, and everything I was angry about, and everything that I was hurt about, and everything that I blamed on mistakes that I made, decisions that I made that were wrong when I thought they were right, things that have happened in my life, all of that always caused some deep form of anger. And it stopped me in some way from really, really, really letting go and being with God 100% and giving myself over to this total and complete love that I'm always wishing to experience. In other words, my tshuva, I realized, was in a way hampered by that spark of anger that I had. And then came his answer. Gamzu letova. Also this is for the good. And all of a sudden, I realized that every single thing that has happened in my life and every single movement that I made in my life and every single decision I made in my life and every place that I've lived and every tear that I've shed and every emotion that I felt and every difficulty that I experienced, Gamzu letova. Also this is for the good. It's very difficult to talk about Gamzu letova when you lose a child, like I've lost my daughter. And then I sat down and I started to think who she was to me, what she meant to me, what her life gave to me, what her death gave to me, what my promise to her before she died gave to me. And I realized and I understood in a second that her life was dedicated to making my life the mission that it is. And that when her life and her mission was finished, Hashem took her back. And he left me to complete mine. Gamzule tova. Also this is for the good. I realized that only because of the fact that she died did I write the first book on the voice, which has helped thousands upon thousands of people regain their voices, sing. It was the promise that she extracted from me before she died to write the book and to share my knowledge about the voice that made me do it. Otherwise, I never would have. Gamzu letova. She's the one who spurred me on to continue painting, which I haven't done. However, in the second book, Soul Reflections, there are my paintings published again. And I've decided to actually start painting again because I must fulfill the promise that I made to her. Gamzu letova. And I realized that even though I miss her so much, and there is such a void in my life because she is not here, that Hashem sent her to me to give me something so special for a while. And leave me with an influence that will guide and last my whole life until the day I die, until the day we meet again. Gamzuletva. So the whole idea of anger, angry at each other, angry at God, angry at the guy who's driving wrong in the street and making an extra effort to pass somebody on the road because he's not going fast enough, and you're annoyed at him because you want to get home. Gamzu letova. Who knows? Maybe because he drove a little bit slower, he saved your life. Maybe because the plane didn't come on time and you were standing and waiting for hours, your life was saved. You don't know why things occur in life. And you don't know why you turned down the street on the right when really you wanted to go to the left, but on the right, all of a sudden there is a store and there is something that you see that just is the right thing that you want to buy for someone you love. Hashem is in control. Hashem is the basis for everything that goes on in our lives. And how could you be angry anyway at someone who gave you such an incredible world to live in? who gave you such incredible opportunities and such incredible possibilities and potential. Somebody who built the world. Somebody who gave you Shabbos. A God who gives you nature, who gives you flowers and who gives you trees, and who gives you clouds, and who creates the most beautiful children, and who creates the most beautiful you. How can you be angry? Drop it. Forget about it. Gamzu letova. One of the great, 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 great lessons I learned in my life. Gamzu letova. And that is probably one of the greatest, greatest gifts that I can give you for this new year. Because if you can allow yourself to look at the world and every single thing that happens in your life and understand that there is a great, great divine plan and a great reason behind whatever it is, no matter how absurd it may seem now, no matter how superfluous it may be at the moment, somewhere down the line, it will wind up to be Gamzu Letova. I invite you to write to me. I invite you to talk to me. And your questions are important. And our conversation is important. I want to tell you about a friend of mine who is opening a new play on Thursday of this week at the Queen's Theater in the Park, in the Flushing Park, right near Shea Stadium. It's called Nobel Laureate. The actor is Avi Hoffman, probably the finest Jewish actor in the world today. Many, many awards, recipient of great honors, PBS specials, wonderful, wonderful show called Too Jewish that you can watch on PBS regularly. The Nobel Laureate is about the writer Isaac Bischoff Singer, who was a very, very controversial figure, who talked about Kabbalah and mysticism at a time when Madonna was not around, and Kabbalah was not a household word. But Isaac Bischoff Singer was a writer who did an amazing, amazing, amazing amount of writing of Jewish literature, and beautiful, beautiful writing at that. Love him. I love him. The show was written by Avi's mother, an extraordinary, extraordinary woman, a professor at Columbia of Yiddish, and she wrote this beautiful, beautiful play, which opens on Thursday, this Thursday, and you can call for tickets. The number is 718-760-0064. Again, 718-760-0064 at the Queen's Theater in the Park. you want to really try to go and see that, because it promises to be extraordinary. The other writer's name is Rena Berkowitz Burrow. The two of them are extraordinary women. The direction is by Avi Hoffman. He also plays the lead. And I think that you need to go see it if you possibly can. So here I gave you a kaleidoscope of a lot of different things. My websites, www.soulreflections-poetry.com, www.musicvisionsintl.com, my personal email, soulreflections9@aol.com. All right. And we will talk. I want to share with you, before I go, something that I wrote about a man who taught me to listen, Rabbi and Rebbetzin Leah and Yoel Kahn. Learning to listen. I sat at their table mesmerized by the light of Shabbos, captivated by his presence, awed and rapt, breathing shallow at best, fearing to not understand his words. His beautiful young hands drawing, accentuating his thoughts, gesticulating, emphasizing, giving them life. His spirit smiling faintly all the while, light from within shining upon his countenance, gentle lines forming around his eyes, his soul awakening the message of Mashiach. I draw closer, a word here and there I can fathom, but not the coherent, concise, sensible content I seek. I sat, baffled, lost, and superfluous. He turns to his wife, beloved confidant, companion, his illuminations to share, it seems, only with her. A lifetime together has formed their awareness. She smiles, nods, retorts. She pleases him with her brilliance, always. Inside, I ache from desire to know, to feel, to understand. Conscious mind, be still, be tranquil. The voice inside me softly prods, just listen. Don't seek sense. Sense only the meaning. Open your gates. Barrier, vanish. Holiness draws energy from above. Hashem speaks through his thoughts. Heed the sounds. I enter realms of instinctive hearing, innate knowing. Suddenly, words, language have no bearing on now. His spoken words vibrate their deep meaning inside me. Shabbos, the Rebbe, all flow and exist as the sum total of a tzaddik in our time, at whose table I learn to listen with my soul. Dedicated with deep respect to Kvod HaRav Yoel and Rebbetzin Leah Kahn. Have a wonderful week. We will talk to each other, Mitzvah Shem, next week. Blessings. Blessings.